And welcome to The Art of Being Human. I'm going to start off today by discussing skin disorders and diabetes, and then after that I'm going into the reproductive cycle of females and what that has to do with diabetes, considering the hormonal changes that women go through on a monthly basis. But let's start off with the skin. I don't think there's anybody that hates anything more than getting an itch. Everybody gets an itch and they really hate it. It's uncomfortable, they dig at it, they wish they could stop. The more they scratch, the worse it gets. Well, I'm concerned about skin infections and diabetes because it's pretty prevalent. The skin, of course, is an organ. It is the largest organ of the body. So you have to realize that the skin actually is an organ. It's not just a cover-up. Although it does cover us up, it does protect us from infection, and it does work with us so that we are protected more from infection from the skin than we are if we didn't have it. So we have to have skin. And it's, as I said, the largest organ of the body. Now, there are skin changes that happen when you are diabetic. And this is something that's of concern because it's very common that people who have diabetes also have skin infections. I know, just as an example, and I think I've mentioned this before, but I was in this area, it's before I moved up, but I was in this area and I was going to be teaching some classes. And I came a day sooner than I needed to, just so that I could have some extra time, you know, to work with what I was teaching. I went to bed that night, and I was fine. Everything was good. My feet were fine. The next morning, I got up, and my toe, the big toe of whichever foot it was, I don't remember which foot now, and it was, like, huge. And it didn't hurt. And I looked at it, and I said, what is this? And I couldn't even understand why I would have such a huge toe. Obviously, it was infected, but there was no pain. And when I went to bed the night before, it wasn't even there. There was no infection, or at least none that I could see. And so I ended up by heading to the emergency hospital, the emergency room of the local hospital. And when the doctors came in to look at it, they were dumbfounded. Oh, this is horrible. Look how big your toe is. This must hurt terribly. Well, the truth is there was no pain. But I had a bacterial infection of the foot, and of course it had to be treated. Antibiotics, they wrapped it up, and I still did what I came to do. I still taught my classes, but I was all bandaged up at the time. Now, you know, you have to stop and think. The danger of an infection in the skin is that it can spread. As a matter of fact, it can spread under the surface of the skin so you don't see how far it's gone. I know some people have little growths removed, and the growth under the skin is like an iceberg. Underneath it was a lot more massive than what you could see on top. So they went to the doctor thinking they had this odd little pimple-like protrusion in their skin, and it turned out to be a massive cyst under the skin, and it all had to be removed. So the danger of getting a skin infection is that it spreads, and it spreads underneath, and you may not be aware of just how far it's spreading. So 25% of diabetics have skin infections. I'm not saying all the time, but it's easy to get them. And skin infections can be a sign of and a complication of diabetes. You can have boils, you can have skin abscesses, and you can have bacterial infections, which can be severe, and they can spread internally and have some very serious consequences. Fungal infections also occur in diabetics, and if you have a fungal infection, that opens you up to more and more infections, and it can cause breaks in the skin, and then you get more infections like candida, monilia, yeast infections, and these infections can be somewhat common. Yeast infections thrive in high sugary environments. Anything that's warm, moist, and sweet will attract an infection, and they'll thrive on that. And of course, what better way of getting an infection than in your feet, where it's going to be warm and somewhat moist. And what you get as a result of that, you get redness, you get swelling, you get itching, you get a bad odor from that. And so therefore, you know you've got some kind of an infection. And the most common areas of infection are going to be the feet and the genital areas. Now, diabetes can also cause, and this is kind of related to the skin, it can cause loss of hair, loss of sweat glands, dry skin. Skin and nails can thicken, they can discolor, they can become brown. It's not unusual to have a toe in which the nail has turned brown. The small vessels and the nerves are damaged, so the skin does not get adequate nourishment, and so the skin will break down and you'll have problems with it. So my advice, and I don't want to say too much more about the skin, but my advice is going to be, if you are itching, if you have some kind of an odd pimple that you don't recognize, if there's a little swelling, you need to get it checked immediately, because you don't know what it is, and where you're diabetic and where your sugar is too high, an infection can spread. One word of warning while I think of it, a lot of people soak their feet when they think that they have an infection, and I know a lot of people will soak their feet thinking that the heat of hot water will draw the infection out of them. My foot doctor said, never, never soak your feet if you have an infection in warm water or hot water. The problem is, and most people don't realize it, that heat will open the pores. And when the pores are open in your feet, the infection has a chance to go deeper. So my foot doctor and other people that I know have said, don't soak your feet. Now, I've heard doctors say soak your feet because they think it will help the infection, but actually, it doesn't. It makes the infection more likely to go deeper. I know of some people that have used Lysol to kill an infection. That's very dangerous, because if you get too much Lysol, you can get a very, very bad burn from it. So I know that some people will use just like maybe a half a teaspoon of Lysol and in a pail of hot water, and then it does kill infection, but it makes the skin very dry and it flakes off, and if you're not careful and you get too much, you can get a bad infection from that. So you may as well, you know, just stick to what your doctor says, take the antibiotic creams or whatever he suggests, have it checked. He can cut in and take a lot of infection out and drain it himself or herself, and so you're better off than fiddling around with it and then finding out that you've got a massive infection. Because remember, in diabetics, it's hard to heal infections. It's real easy to get infections if you are diabetic, but it's awfully hard to get rid of them. Diabetics heal slowly, a lot more slowly than you might think. And what might look to you to be just a small cut or a small wound, nothing to worry about, just kind of blow it off, it may turn out to be something that's pretty serious. So you can't neglect your skin. And if you do itch on your back, and if you're married, have somebody check your back and see if there's any kind of an infection or any kind of a rash or something like that on your back, because you can't see your whole body. More or less you can with a mirror, but it's helpful to have somebody else check it. I know people who have cancer, skin cancer, they can give them medication that brings the cancer out so you can see it, and then it can get treated after that. But you may need to have somebody kind of check you and make sure that there are areas in your body that you can't see, make sure that they are all right. So I don't want to really say too much more about that. So about the skins, I just want to give you a heads up. We're coming to the point where we don't have too much more to go on diabetes, but we will have, I think, maybe two or three more sessions on it. I want to turn now to women's cycles and what happens with diabetes if you're a female. It is important to remember that with the female, there's a lot of major hormonal change that goes on every single month. With men, things are easier. They're more or less on an even keel. But remember, the woman is always prepared to have a baby. Her body is always preparing to accept a fertilized egg to have a baby. So there's a constant influx of emotions, that, and a constant influx of hormones back and forth, back and forth. And so that makes it harder for a female who's diabetic. But you can have a very normal pregnancy and you can have a very normal delivery, but it may take a lot of extra time to do it. It may take a lot of extra care. So I want to review what the monthly cycle is in a woman and what the hormones are. And for that purpose, I'm going to go to this chart that I have prepared here. These are the female organs, I made a simplified drawing. But this would be the uterus right here. And it's all shaded. I checked it off kind of in gray. And these would be the fallopian tubes, and these would be the ovaries. And every month, and this is, of course, the cervix right here, and then this is the vagina. This is basic what it is. And what happens is that every month, the uterus lining builds up. This would be the lining of the uterus. It all builds up. And what it's doing is preparing to accept a fertilized egg. Now, an egg is produced once a month by ovaries, one on each side. On one month, one egg will produce, one ovary will produce an egg, and then the next month, the other ovary will produce an egg. So they alternate back and forth like that. I had a friend of mine who had terrible trouble every other month, and she knew that one of her ovaries was in trouble. And she always knew which one it was, because the ovary that was in trouble on that month, she had a very painful month. And then on the following month, she was fine. So one of the ovaries was in trouble. They do alternate back and forth. Now, occasionally, if a person has surgery and they have to take out maybe a fallopian tube, or they have to take out one ovary, then the other ovary will do double duty so that they will produce two eggs or an egg every month rather than every other month. So anyway, you have this lining all built up. And then the ovary, let's say it's this one, it doesn't matter, either one, produces an egg, which goes up the fallopian tube and into the uterus. Now, the sperm, during sexual activity, comes up here from the vagina right up through the cervix. And if that egg is fertilized, then it will, the lining stays, it will embed itself, the fertilized egg will embed itself in the lining of the uterus, which now provides nourishment for it to continue to grow and gradually develop into a full-size baby, and then the baby will be born. But there will be many months when fertilization does not occur for one reason or another. A person may be on birth control pills, there may be other medical issues, maybe she's just not going out with anybody, and so therefore nothing occurs sexually. And so what happens is the egg does not get fertilized. Well, what happens here? That whole lining of the uterus sheds, and it does not remain in the body. It sheds, and this gives you the monthly cycle. And then what does it do? It starts to build up. Once this is all shed, it starts to build up the lining once again to accept a fertilized egg on the following month. So if you want to consider it this way, that the female is always preparing to either become pregnant or on one month or become pregnant on the following month, the uterus is always building up a lining, and if the lining sheds because pregnancy has not occurred, then it builds it up all over again. Another month, no pregnancy, it sheds, and then it starts to build up all over again. So the female body is always geared and to be able to conceive and have a baby. Now, this would occur from teenagerhood, when a girl is first old enough to start having a monthly cycle, until menopause, when the female is old enough that she doesn't have it anymore. So there are childbearing years, and they could be like from age 13. Most girls start out in their maturity at about age 13 or 14, although with the nutrition that some of them get, some of them start much earlier than that. But let's say 13 and 14 is average. Until the time that menopause occurs and is completed, and we might want to say that that could be in the 60s, some people in the 50s, but during those years, and it's going to vary between female and female, between those years, every month the uterus is preparing. Every month the uterus is either going to have a baby or it's shedding the lining and starting to do it all over again. Month by month by month, it never stops. Now, you can imagine the intense hormonal activity that occurs. The estrogen goes up, the estrogen goes down, progesterone goes up, progesterone goes down, on and on and on and on. Now, that does have an effect if you are diabetic, because you already have too much sweetener in the blood, you already have too much sugar in the blood, and what happens is that it makes your life, in terms of being a diabetic, much more complicated because of the intense hormonal activity that's happening in your body. And if you're pregnant, now you've got the business of raising in your uterus, getting a child grown and a child developed to the point where he can be or she can be delivered. And so you have intense hormonal activity in just producing the baby and in letting the baby grow. Remember, the day that the sperm and the ovum connect, and there's only one sperm that can go into an ovum, but the day that that occurs, pregnancy is in effect. And then you are now pregnant, and you now have whatever is inside you is a child. It's not developed yet, but it has all of the genes, you know, that it needs to have in order to become a human baby. It is basically a human being. So I say that life starts at conception. Some people say that life starts when the baby is born. Not so. Life starts at conception, because when you conceive, that egg accepts that sperm, that one sperm, and closes itself off to all others. And then cell division occurs. And what you get in cell division is you get the beginnings of the baby. And it occurs very rapidly. One cell into two, two cells into four, four cells into eight, and it happens immediately after conception. So you are growing this individual, you are growing this baby at the point of conception. So I don't believe that when people say that life doesn't start until birth, that's not true. You couldn't have growth if you didn't have life, and the baby is growing and developing, and even at 2 months, after conception, the baby's only about the size of a grape, but it already has some of the internal organs starting to form. The heart is starting to form. It has four chambers. It's starting to spasm. It's trying to have a heartbeat, like a normal heartbeat. And you already have a pancreas that's formed, and it's already producing a little insulin. And if the mother is diabetic, and we've already discussed gestational diabetes, but if the mother is diabetic, then what's going to happen is the baby's insulin is going to try to fight off the extra sugar that it's getting from the mother's blood, or the nourishment that comes from the mother's blood. And so therefore, you already have, within the size of an infant, really a zygote, a little tiny pancreas producing insulin, and it's already being fighting off the mother's extra sugar. That's a normal human response, even though the baby's only the size of a grape. I think when I did this, when I talked about this before, I said that the baby at 8 weeks was about 1.5 to 2 inches long. You can compare that to a fairly large grape, and this is what it is. That's the size of it. But it's operating like a human being, or gradually developing. So The growth is there, and it starts immediately upon conception, and therefore you have, at the end of 9 months, you do have a human being that's going to be delivered. So life starts at conception, but it's also influenced by all of the hormonal changes that are going on in the human female at the time that the baby is being carried. And also you can see that if you're diabetic and you're fighting this illness, and the illness gets progressive with time, and so there are the baby's hormones, there's the female hormones, there's whatever going on with the diabetes, it can get to be pretty complicated. But even though it's complicated, it doesn't mean that a woman can't conceive and have a healthy child. And even though she may be diabetic and is diabetic and has gestational diabetes, it doesn't mean that the baby will be diabetic. If the baby becomes diabetic, it may not be when it's born, it may be several years later. And when it does get diabetes, it may be type 2 rather than type 1. But just because the mother's diabetic or has gestational diabetes does not mean that the child is going to be diabetic too. But there are complications involved, and it gets to be very complicated in terms of hormonal development. So I really wanted to talk about that, because if you are a female, it's complicated by the fact that you have hormonal changes through the month, whether you're pregnant or not. And let's say you're not, you still have a lot of hormonal changes every single month. The uterus builds up, the uterus sheds, the uterus builds up, the uterus sheds. There's just something going on all the time within your system because you're a female. That's a part of being a female. And so therefore, it becomes complicated as a female to be diabetic due to hormonal changes, and it's going to continue to be complicated if it turns out that you become pregnant and have a baby and you're also diabetic. But with extra care, extra nurturance, you can have a normal baby. Even though the baby may be a little larger, the baby can still be healthy. Now, we've almost run out of time, so I'm going to close it here. And the next time, I'm going to go into a little bit about the brain and what it has to do with hormonal activity, and then we'll go on from there. So we'll close it here. Please join me next time.